Krishna, my dear devotees, how are you doing today?
Hare Krishna, Mataji, Dhanyavad Pranam, Jai Shri Prabhupada.
Hare Krishna, Mataji, Dhanyavad Pranam.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna to all devotees.
Come on, time today.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna to everybody.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Sunal Mataji, and all of you. At some point in the presentation today, please open up your camera so that I can see you. Okay, so are we recording this call? Yes, we are. Okay, today is Thursday, and you know, my next meeting starts promptly at 8 o'clock. Right? Sadhana Mataji told me, send her regrets. She has, I think she's visiting some place, so you know, she's in some other place. So might not be able to join us today. So we have.
That's why I was to suggest, Shraddha Mataji, on Thursdays, maybe we should just after the prayers go to the verse so we have enough time.
I was just saying that we could just do Om Agyan Timran Dasya.
Yeah.
Straight away go to Gita. Does that work for you all?
Yeah.
All right. Om Agyan Timran Dasya. Jnananjana shalakaya chakshurun militam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha. Okay, so now I'm going to bring up the chapter 2. And which verse are we doing today?
39.
Again?
Yes.
All right. Well, there was a little bit of unhappiness. You have already read the Bhagavad Gita. All of you are on this call have already read the Bhagavad Gita several times, right? Or right? Or not right?
Right.
Right? Right. So there should not be any hurry to finish it. Okay? Don't be in a hurry to finish it. Instead, what you're going to do, you're going to relish it. And relishment comes when you go slow. When you go slowly, then you'll be able to understand, go deeper into the purports. And then really, it's all about going deeper. And why I'm saying that is because if you really want the gems and if you really want the pearls, then you have to really go deep inside the ocean.
Deep down.
Right? Deep down to get it. So that's what it is. Okay. So since we are going to start reading now, can we have some sort of a reading order? What do you think?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay. So I'm going to mute you all right now, temporarily. Please stay muted. Don't unmute yourself because that will bring up your names in the alphabetical order on my panel here. So Archana Mataji, Aruni Mataji. Oh, Deepal Mataji is here. I'm happy to have you back. And then Sonal Mataji. Okay, and pardon my typos, I'm not very good at typing. Sutapa Mataji, Varshana Mataji, and Vijaya Lakshmi Mataji. And that's it. And then we have Niral and Kathy are there, so I will squeeze them in the order.
After I keep one name.
Niral only, okay. So Archana Aruni Mataji, Deepal Mataji, Niral Prabhu or Khyati Mataji, Sonal Mataji, Sudapa Mataji, Varshana Mataji, and Vijaya Lakshmi Mataji. So I'm going to skip the reading.
Aruni Mataji can't read, Mataji.
She just texted, she can't read. Okay, Aruni Mataji. Then we also have Sulekha. Can she read? Can Sulekha Mataji read? Sulekha, can you read?
Yes.
Okay.
I can read, Mataji.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, good. Because your voice was breaking, so I could not hear you properly here. Okay, so I have some sort of a reading order, which we know in momentarily will be changed as everything in this world, material world.
Mother, you should copy the reading order in a text file because Zoom doesn't allow copy paste.
There you go. I was working off of a text file. There
oh,
you
awesome.
Go. You are... yeah. I suffered 2 days. I suffered Zoom chat.
Sorry, 2 days.
God wise. Okay, so whose turn is it to read?
Archana
Mataji, it's my turn.
Archana Mataji, it's your
yes.
turn? All right.
Yeah, it's my turn. Mataji.
Okay, but there's something I need to do, right? Before you can read? Basically.
Yeah, I can't see the screen, I mean, the verse.
You can't see the verses? You can't see?
Yeah,
the...
Mataji.
Can you?
No.
Oh, and nobody can see, is it? Right. Can anybody see?
No.
Nobody can see. Why is it?
We cannot see, Mataji.
Oh, this is crazy. Okay, one more time. All right. This time, maybe?
Can see, Mataji.
Yes, Mataji. Now it's visible.
Okay, run for it.
Mataji, after whom I am? Varshana Mataji?
After Sutapa.
Okay. I'll read out the order, Mataji.
After Varshana, sorry.
Let me read out the order once. So... it's Archana Mataji, Deepal Mataji, Niral, Sonal Mataji, Sulekha Mataji, Sutappa Mataji, Varshana Mataji, Vijayalakshmi Mataji, and then Shraddha.
I'm not reading.
Oh, okay.
I'm not in a position to read.
That is true, Mataji.
Okay. All right, let's get going. We have very little time today, so let's get going. So verses will be from 39, isn't it? 39. Okay, here you go. All yours, Archana.
Yeah, Mataji. Text 39. Thus far, I have described this knowledge to you through analytical study. Now listen as I explain it in terms of working without fruitive results. O son of Pritha, when you act in such knowledge, you can free yourself from the bondage of works. Text 40. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution, and a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. Hare Krishna.
Text 41. Those who are on the path are resolute in purpose and their aim is one. O beloved child of the Kurus, the intelligence of those who are irresolute is many branched. 42 and 43. Men of small knowledge are very much attached to the flowery words of the Vedas, which recommend various fruitative activities for elevation of heavenly planets, resultant good birth, power, and so forth. Being desirous of sense gratification and opulent life, they say that there is nothing more than this.
Text 44. In the minds of those who are too attached to sense enjoyment and material opulence and who are bewildered by such things, the resolute determination for devotional service to the Supreme Lord does not take place. The Vedas deal mainly with the subject of three modes of material nature. O Arjuna, become transcendental to these three modes. Be free from all dualities and from all anxieties for gain and safety, and be established in the self.
Text 46. All purposes served by a small well can at once be served by a great reservoir of water. Similarly, all the purposes of the Vedas can be served to one who knows the purpose behind them. Text 47. You have a right to perform your prescribed duty, but you are not entitled to the fruits of action. Never consider yourself the cause of the results of your activities and never be attached to not doing your duty.
Sulekha Mataji.
Text 48. Perform your duty equipoised. O Arjuna, abandoning all attachment to success or failure. Such equanimity is called yoga. Text 49. O Dhyana Dhananjaya, keep all abominable activities far distant by devotional service, and in that consciousness surrender unto the Lord. Those who want to enjoy the fruits of their work are misers.
Text 50. A man engaged in devotional service rids himself of both good and bad reactions even in this life. Therefore, strive for yoga, which is the art of all work. Text 51. By thus engaging in devotional service to the Lord, great sages or devotees free themselves from the results of work in the material world. In this way, they become free from the cycle of birth and death and attain the state beyond all miseries by going back to Godhead. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, text 52. When your intelligence has been passed out of the dense forest of delusion, you shall become indifferent to all that has heard and all that is to be heard. 53. When your mind is no longer disturbed by the flowery language of the Vedas and when it remains fixed in the trance of self-realization, then you will have attained the divine consciousness. Hare Krishna.
Text 54. Arjuna said, O Krishna, what are the symptoms of one whose consciousness is thus merged in transcendence? How does he speak? And what is his language? How does he sit? And how does he walk? Text 55. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, O Partha, when a man gives up all varieties of desire for sense gratification, which arise from mental concoction, and when his mind, thus purified, finds satisfaction in the self alone, then he is said to be in pure transcendental consciousness. Hare Krishna.
Text 56. One who is not disturbed in mind, even amidst the threefold miseries, or elated when there is happiness, and who is free from attachment, fear, and anger, is called a sage of steady mind. Text 57. In the material world, one who is unaffected by whatever good or evil he may obtain, neither praising it nor despising it, is firmly fixed in perfect knowledge. Hare Krishna.
Text 58. One who is able to withdraw his senses from sense objects, as the tortoise draws its limbs within the shell, is firmly fixed in perfect consciousness. Text 59. Though the embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment, the taste of sense objects remains. But seizing such engagements by experiencing a higher taste, he is fixed in consciousness.
Text 60. The senses are so strong and impetuous, O Arjuna, that they forcibly carry away the mind even of a man of discrimination who is endeavoring to control them. One who restrains his senses, keeping them under full control, and fixes his consciousness upon me is known as a mind of steady intelligence.
While contemplating the objects of the senses, a person develops attachment for them, and from such attachment, lust develops, and from lust, anger arises. Text 63, from anger, complete delusion arises, and from delusion, bewilderment of memory. When memory is bewildered, intelligence is lost, and when intelligence is lost, one falls down again into the material pool.
I can't hear you, but I can hear an aeroplane.
I live close to the airport. Actually, I joined from my laptop, so the chat has disappeared. I can't find who I'm after. Can I just confirm? So I'm after...
Sonal Mataji.
After Sonal Mataji. Okay. Text 64. But a person free from all attachment and aversion and able to control his senses through regulative principles of freedom can obtain the complete mercy of the Lord. Text 65. For one thus satisfied in Krishna consciousness, the threefold miseries of material existence exist no longer. In such satisfied consciousness, one's intelligence is soon well established.
Text 66. One who is not connected with the Supreme in Krishna consciousness can have neither transcendental intelligence nor a steady mind, without which there is no possibility of peace. And how can there be any happiness without peace? Text 67. As a strong wind sweeps away a boat on the water, even one of the roaming senses on which the mind focuses can carry away a man's intelligence. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, text 68. Therefore, O mighty armed, one whose senses are restrained from the objects is certainly of steady intelligence. Text 69. What is the night for all beings is time of awakening for the self-controlled, and the time of awakening for all beings is night for the introspective sages. Hare Krishna.
Text 70, a person who is not disturbed by the incessant flow of desires that enter like rivers into the ocean, which is ever being filled but is always still, can alone achieve peace, and not the man who strives to satisfy such desires. Text 71, a person who has given up all desires for sense gratification, who lives free from desire, who has given up all sense of proprietorship and is devoid of false ego, he alone can attain real peace. Hare Krishna.
Text 72. That is the way of spiritual and godly life, after attaining which a man is not bewildered. If one is thus situated, even at the hour of death, one can enter into the kingdom of God. Hari Bol.
Hari Bol. Okay, so we go back to verse number 38. 39. What did we do last time?
We recite the verse, but you told that we will go deep in today.
All right. Esha te bihita shanke. All right. Whose turn is it to read?
प्रयाहसी
अभिहिता described sankhye in analytical study, buddhihi intelligence, yoge in work without productive results, tu but imam this, shrinu just hear, buddhya by intelligence, yuktah dovetailed, yaya by which, partha o son of pritha, karma bandham, bondage of reaction. Prahasyasi, you can be released from.
Translation. Thus far, I have described this knowledge to you through analytical study. Now listen as I explain it in terms of working without fruitive results. O son of Pritha, when you act in such knowledge, you can free yourself from the bondage of works.
Purport. According to Nirukti or the Vedic dictionary, Sankhya means that which describes things in details, and Sankhya refers to that philosophy which describes the real nature of the soul, and yoga involves controlling the senses. Arjuna's proposal not to fight was based on sense gratification. Forgetting his prime duty, he wanted to cease fighting because he thought that by not killing his relatives and kinsmen, he would be happier than by enjoying the kingdom after conquering his cousins and brothers, the sons of Dhritarashtra. In both ways, the basic principles were for sense gratification. Happiness derived from conquering them and happiness derived from seeing kingsmen alive are both on the basis of personal sense gratification, even at a sacrifice of wisdom and duty. Krishna therefore wanted to explain to Arjuna that by killing the body of his grandfather, he would not be killing the soul proper. And he explained that all the individual persons, including the Lord himself, are eternal individuals. They are individuals in the past, they are individuals in the present, and they will continue to remain individuals in the future. Because all of us are individual souls eternally.
We simply change our bodily dress in different manners, but actually we keep our individuality even after liberation from the bondage of material dress. An analytical study of the soul and the body has been very graphically explained by Lord Krishna, and this descriptive knowledge of the soul and the body from different angles of vision has been described here as Sankhya in terms of Nirukti dictionary. This Sankhya has nothing to do with the Sankhya philosophy to the atheist Kapila. Long before the imposter Kapila's Sankhya, the Sankhya philosophy was expounded in the Srimad Bhagavatam by the true Lord Kapila, the incarnation of Lord Krishna, who explained it to his mother Devahuti. It is clearly explained by him that the Purusha or the Supreme Lord is active and that he creates by looking over the Prakriti. This is accepted in the Vedas and in the Gita. The description in the Vedas indicates that the Lord glances over the Prakriti. Prakriti or nature, and impregnated in without atomic individual souls. All these individuals are walking in the material world for sense gratification, and under the spell of material energy, they are thinking of being enjoyers. This mentality is dragged to the last point of liberation when the living entity wants to become one with the Lord. This is the last snare of Maya or sense gratificatory illusion. And it is only after many, many births of such sense gratificatory activities that a great soul surrenders unto Vasudeva, Lord Krishna, thereby fulfilling the search after the ultimate truth. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Arjuna has already accepted Krishna as his spiritual master by surrendering himself unto him. Shishyasteham shadhi mam tvam prapannam. Consequently, Krishna will now tell him about the working process of buddhi yoga or karma yoga, or in other words, the practice of devotional service only for sense gratification of the Lord. This buddhi yoga is clearly explained in chapter 10, verse 10, as being direct communion with the Lord, who is sitting as Paramatma in everyone's heart. But such communion does not take place without devotional service. One who is therefore situated in the devotional or transcendental loving service to the Lord, in other words, in Krishna consciousness, attained to the stage of buddhi yoga by special grace of the Lord. The Lord says, therefore, that only to those who are always engaged in devotional service out of transcendental love does he award the pure knowledge of the devotion and love. In that way, the devotee can reach him easily in every blissful kingdom of God. Hare Krishna.
Thus, the buddhi yoga mentioned in this verse is the devotional service of the Lord, and the word sankhya mentioned herein has nothing to do with the atheistic sankhya yoga enunciated by the imposter Kapila. One should not therefore misunderstand that the sankhya yoga mentioned herein has any connection with the atheistic sankhya, nor did the philosophy has any influence during that time, nor would Lord Krishna care to mention such godless philosophical speculations. Real sankhya philosophy is described by Lord Kapila in the Srimad Bhagavatam, but even the sankhya has nothing to do with the current topics. Here, sankhya means analytical description of the body and the soul. Lord Krishna made an analytical description of the soul just to bring Arjuna to the point of buddhi yoga or bhakti yoga. Therefore, Lord Krishna's sankhya and Lord Kapila's sankhya, as described in the Bhagavatam, are one and the same. They are all bhakti yoga. Lord Krishna said, therefore, that only the less intelligent class of men make a distinction between Sankhya Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. Sankhya Yoga Pridak Bala Pravadanti Na Panditaha. Hare Krishna.
Of course, atheistic Sankhya Yoga has nothing to do with Bhakti Yoga, yet the unintelligent claim that atheistic Sankhya Yoga is referred to in the Bhagavad Gita. Hare Krishna.
One should therefore understand that buddhi yoga means to work in Krishna consciousness in the full bliss and knowledge of devotional service. One who works for the satisfaction of the Lord only, however difficult such work may be, is working under the principles of buddhi yoga and finds himself always in transcendental bliss. By such transcendental engagement, one achieves all transcendental understanding automatically by the grace of the Lord. And thus his liberation is complete in itself, without his making extraneous endeavors to acquire knowledge. There is much difference between work in Krishna consciousness and work for fruitive results, especially in the matter of sense gratification for achieving results in terms of family or material happiness. Buddhi yoga is therefore the transcendental quality of the work that we perform.
Hari Bol. So we have Garima Mataji join us. Does that mean a change in the reading order, Garima Mataji?
Mataji,
no, Mataji. Yeah. Good, 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 good. All right. So we have read this whole thing and it's time for us to do some reflections. So I'm going to stop sharing the screen and we'll go all into the speaker view mode so that we can see each other in all glories. So thoughts, comments.
Hare Krishna Mataji. Mataji, here I really liked it, so that happiness derived from conquering them and happiness derived by seeing kinsmen alive are both on the basis of personal sense gratification, even at a sacrifice of wisdom and duty. So Arjuna, both depend on his personal sense gratification.
Yes.
At this moment, yeah.
Yeah.
Mataji, the last line, Buddhi Yoga is therefore the transcendental quality of the work we perform. So is there any specific meaning of Buddhi Yoga?
So what is, give me some example of transcendental work that you perform and then we will understand the meaning of. It says Buddhi Yoga is
transcendental. Yoga means work in Krishna consciousness.
Very good. Yes. Anything that you do in Krishna consciousness is transcendental in nature.
Yeah.
Right? Anything that you do, right? There's a verse that comes later on in Bhagavad Gita. So, Buddhi. So let's look at, first just look at the word yoga. What does yoga mean, right? Yoga means to connect.
Connect
with God. Connect,
right? Like you also see the word yoke. Yoke in English has come from yoga. The yoke is used when you have got ox, right? And you are connecting them to the plow when you go to the fields, right? With the bull or the ox that you use there. So yoga basically means to connect, so you can connect to the Lord. So usually, although yoga means connect, but we don't use the term yoga just like that. And what are you doing? You know, I'm connecting the phone call. No, I'm doing a yoga with the phone. No. Usually we use it in terms of connecting with the Lord, right? And so the connection with the Lord can happen through various means, right? So connection can happen by thinking about somebody, right? By doing something to somebody, you are connected, right? By describing somebody, you are connected. By touching somebody, you are connected to that person, right? So connection can happen at various levels and through different means. Okay, then there are some very loose connections and then there are some very intimate connections, right? To some people, we are connected more intimately. We will expose more of our inner things to them. But for others, it's more like, all right, fine, you know, just handshake and goodbye like that. So connecting basically means, right? Yoga basically means you're connecting to the Lord and you can connect to the Lord in so many ways. Well, Krishna will tell later on in Bhagavad Gita chapter 7, Chatur Vidha Bhajante Mam Jana Sukritino Arjuna Artho Jigyasu Artharti Jnani Cha Bharata Rishabha. Right? So there are four kinds of people who come to the Lord. Artho, Artharti. Artho means those who are in distress. So you're connecting to the Lord because you are in distress. So you're still thinking about, like you made the reflection when you read, you know, that Arjuna was saying that, whether I do, or was it Varshana who said that Arjuna is thinking, in both the cases, he's thinking about his own sense gratification, right? So at the lowest level that you connect with God is that, you know, you are in, you want to enjoy something, and artho, that is artharthi, right? Artharthi means he's trying to find some gain for himself, and he connects with the Lord because he knows from where the stuff comes. He's figured that part out, so he goes there. Then you could also be in some distress, like Gajendra was in distress, so he connected with the Lord. He remembered after struggling for 10,000 years, then he suddenly remembers prayers from his previous birth and he starts reciting those prayers, and then Krishna comes, right? So that sort of the artho jigyasu. And then we have jigyasu, those who are the curious people. They're just curious, they have figured it out, so something is happening. There's some sort of a superior control, so they're curious, they want to find out who that supreme controller is. So that way they connect with the Lord. And then Jnani is the one who knows that there is God, and then he tries to connect to the Lord. He knows that there is God, like that. So the word Jnani is used in that context over there. And so these are various kinds of people who are connecting with the Lord. So you can see that the way you use your intelligence, right? You the first person who was doing karmakandi activities, he wanted to enjoy, right? And so there's karmakandi activities. What is the English for karmakandi activities? What are karmakandi activities called in English?
Fruitive workers.
Yeah, fruitive activities. So fruit, from the word fruit means, what is fruit called in Hindi?
Phal.
Right? So when you are focusing on the karam phal, when you're focusing on the results of your action, that is called fruitive. So it's not fruitative, it doesn't have so many T's inside it, it's fruitive. The fruitive activities, so when you are focused on that, so that is the lowest level. Are you using intelligence? Yes, you're using your intelligence because you have figured it out from where all these things are coming, right? So you figure that out, and then there'll be some intelligence required to do whatever yagyas are performed, you have to earn money. So it's not that you're dumb and you're just doing it, right? So there is some intelligence. And then as you go further up the yoga ladder, you're using your intelligence, but the right use of your intelligence is when you're doing devotional service to the Lord, right? That is the right way, right and the best. And the only way why you should be connecting to the Lord and using your intelligence would be to connect to the Lord, right? So when you connect to the Lord using the right use of your intelligence, that results in, I mean, the end result of that will be devotional service, because that is the right way of using your intelligence. And that is why when you do devotional service to the Lord, that is also known as buddhi yoga, right? When you're using your buddhi to the hilt, to the highest level that you can use your intelligence, that is called buddhi yoga. Okay, so buddhi yoga and bhakti yoga, these terms Krishna will be used here, but they mean the same thing.
Mataji, there are two. They said one is a bad Kapil and there is a good Kapil. Kapila, sage Kapila.
And then there is Kapil Dev, that cricketer. Yeah. So the real Kapil Dev is actually a plenary, which means a complete incarnation of the Lord. So there's a story in Srimad Bhagavatam about a muni called Kardam Muni. And Kardam Muni is actually performing austerities in Bindu Sarovar, in the area called Bindu Sarovar, right? So it's a big sarovar, big lake up in the Himalayas, right? And the river that became extinct, which is no longer visible in the Kali Yuga, the Saraswati River, right? That Saraswati River, which we can't see because it's gone underground, that river actually originates from Bindu Sarovar up in the Himalayas. So Kardam Muni was performing extreme austerities in the Bindu Sarovar area. And why I'm saying area is that because when he was performing austerities there was no Bindu Sarovar at that time. But seeing him do so much of austerities there, the Lord felt so, you know, touched by the efforts of the devotee that tears came into his eyes. And then those tears formed what is called as the Bindu Sarovar. Okay. So Kardam Muni actually wanted to get married. And he was performing devotional service for that. So he's there, and then as a result of his intense devotional service, the Lord comes and appears before him and talks to him and saying that I'm very pleased and all this stuff. And then, Kardam Muni is very happy and he says, this will happen, that will happen, and you will come back to me and all those kind of things he talks. But more important, all this is going on, but Kardam Muni says, all that is good, my Lord. but I was actually wanting to have a wife. And the Lord, who is Bhavagrahi Janardhan, who knows everything that is happening in everybody's heart, he said, yes, I knew that. And I've already arranged. So from 3 days from now, Manu, Swayambhuva Manu, is going to come with his daughter Devahuti. And he's going to ask you to, you know, marry her. And so you can get married to her like that. So Kardamuni gets married to Devahuti. And remember, Devahuti is a princess. So she's coming from a royal, you know, comfort level. But the princesses were trained in those days to serve the sages. Of course, Kardamuni is one. And then, of course, to serve their husbands if needed. So it was not like, you know, I'm coming from a royal kingdom, so I won't do this and I won't do that. A woman, whoever she was married to, would just adjust her lifestyle to the standards of her husband like that, which is a good way, because if you don't adjust to the standards of your husband, you'll always be demanding things, right? And there's no end to materialism like that, and stress and fight and all those kind of things. So she serves her husband so diligently. She neglects her body. She becomes so thin and emaciated, and she doesn't even have time to comb her hair. She just dips the hair in the water, and then it's all matted and bad and things like that. So one day, after many, many years of marriage, Kardamuni notices that he has a wife. and then he feels, when he looks at her, he feels bad. And then, but he has got mystic powers because of doing so much of devotional service. He attains some mystic powers. And so by his mystic powers, he touches Devahuti, and she comes back to her youthful looks. And then he also creates, through his mystic powers, many, many maid servants. So they take her there, you know, wash her in Bindu Sarovar, they braid her hair and all that kind of stuff. And then Kardamuni actually also creates a whole planet. So he creates a castle, which is a planet by itself, which means it flies. And so he creates a whole planet for her, for his wife. And then they go and they enjoy for 100 years. Now, one of the conditions that Kardamuni had for marrying was that, you know, to his wife was that, you know, I'm really into devotional service, and I will, when you have a son, then I will leave, you know, I'll go for vanprastha and things like that. So anyway, Devahuti and her husband, they enjoy, and there's a very beautiful description of the planet that he created in the Bhagavatam, third canto. And so he, they enjoy, and 100 years go by, and they don't even realize that. The good time goes by very fast. And then towards the end, she has nine daughters. She has nine daughters, and they are very famous because from there more progeny comes, right? And so then their nine daughters are born, and then Kapildev says, I'm leaving. And so when he's leaving home, then Devahuti starts lamenting. And then she comes and he says, but then you had said that when we're going to have a son, then you will leave, but I don't have any son, so you can't leave. So then Kardamuni stays back, and then they have a son. And that son is actually the Supreme Personality of Godhead incarnated as Kapildev. And so then Kardamuni stays back for a little more, some more time, like son grows up a little bit, but then finally he goes. And then finally when he leaves and goes away, then Devahuti realizes that, oh my God, what have I done? I lived my whole life with a sage like Kardamuni. And what did I ask? I wanted a honeymoon 100 years long. I wanted to have daughters, nine of them. I wanted to have a son. I got one more son. I should have instead made the most of this association, right? Of being with a Rishi and becoming Rishi-like, as Sutapa Mataji had pointed out, the milk and the curd, right? That association. So she starts lamenting. And then she says that this material energy has just fooled me. I have been fooled by the material energy. I've wasted my whole life. Now what do I do, you know? Then Kapildev goes and explains the entire, her son. So this is a son teaching the mother. So Srimad Bhagavatam is full of these kinds of paradigm shifts. Usually the parents teach to the kids. But in Srimad Bhagavatam, the kids can teach the parents, right? Because it's very much focused on the soul. It doesn't matter what kind of a body you are on in, a younger person can teach an older person like that. So then Kapil Dev gives her the understanding of Sankhya. So that is the real Kapila. And then later on, and I don't know the exact time, Niral Prabhu, that there was another Kapil Dev. He also came up with some, you know, Sankhya philosophy, which is not the exact and the correct Sankhya philosophy. So Prabhupada is pointing out to that later atheistic Kapil Dev, and he says, not that one. We're talking about the Sankhya philosophy of Supreme Lord himself when he came in the form of Kapil Dev. And so there's a book by Prabhupada called Teachings of Lord Kapil Dev. Right? So it's an extraction from Srimad Bhagavatam. It's a good book to read like that.
One thing I have a doubt, Mataji. See, and in life, you know, they say, Brahmacharya and Grihastha and Vanaprastha and Sannyasa. So when he reached that stage, how come he had that kind of wish or what can I say? You know, he wanted to marry. So
he was not a sannyasi. He was in the brahmachari stage, right? And so what happens during the brahmachari stage is complete celibacy, right? So you are asked to stay celibate, because if you stay celibate, then you can assimilate the shastras more, right? You can assimilate it much more because your brain substance is more sharp when you are a brahmachari. But the desires can come from previous life also. Right? The desires will stay there. We have to remember that this material world is actually based off of desire. It's situated on desire. It is created because of desire, right? What was our desire because of which material world is created? What was the desire because of which they created? Right? What was our desire?
Anyway. To be happy.
Mataji wanted to enjoy.
You wanted to enjoy? Varshana Mataji, what were you saying?
What was your question, Mataji?
Okay. I was asking, why was this material world created?
For sense enjoyment,
right. So I will just qualify that with one more clause. To enjoy independent of Krishna. Right? That is the reason this material world is created. You want to enjoy independent of Krishna, so you go there, independent, and try to enjoy like that. Right? So people will have desires. So, and because of desire, you get a body. And also remember that desires will lie dormant in your body till the body reaches a stage where you can indulge in that desire. Right?
No, my only question is, you know, when you reach and when you know the shastras and everything.
Yeah, you think.
Then when you come back like this kind of feeling, then what is the?
Desire, that's what I'm saying. That desire can lie dormant. The desires will lie dormant in you and then they will raise their head. You raise their head. And if you are all alone sitting up near Bindu Sarovar, there's nobody going to tell you, hey, don't waste your life. What are you doing? Like that. Right? It is desire, desire, and desire. Sometimes you see that the young kids are very good. They are studying very nicely in school. They are like the best. Their teachers pet, every parents pet, everything. And then they go off to college and they become a monster. Like, oh, this girl or this boy, oh, he used to be first in class. What? He drinks now every day? They were just waiting for the suitable opportunity and a suitable body.
Freedom. Right? They wanted freedom. That's why.
Yeah. Apart from, no, even if they have the freedom, like, you know, a one-year-old child has a freedom. Parents are not putting too much on them. Parents are not telling a one-year-old child not to drink. Right? But it doesn't have that capacity, doesn't have the body, the desire is lying dormant. But the same person can, that's why sometimes you see, like, you know, Tommy committed murder. I can't believe that. He was just waiting for the circumstances and the body to become sufficiently, you know, suitable to be able to indulge in that desire. Right? So
Mataji, it, the bad and good desires means comes automatically, or we can
from samskara. They will come from
all the desires, kind of
every desire comes from your mind. Yes, the soul desires it, and then it gets stored in the mind, and the mind will keep on referring to it, and then bringing them up, and then showing you that, you know, how about this, how about that, and the mind will take the impetus from the senses, right? So, for example, if you have a desire to eat a mango, the soul has a desire to eat a mango. Okay, nothing can be done to the desire. At least when I was growing up, mangoes came only in the summers. There was not a single mango to be seen during winters. So that is, winter is there. There is no mango. Fine. The desire is lying dormant. Okay. Now summer comes. The eyes will go and catch a mango. Then the mind will immediately present the thought, mango, eat. Now the buddhi, intelligent, can present that and give a recommendation also to the soul that mango, bad for you, diabetes, like that. But the soul can still decide that I don't care if I get diabetes or not. I want to eat it now and eat it and suffer later. That's a different story. Or might say, okay, yeah, I should not, and I should stay away from it, like that, right? So desire will stay dormant, and then they will be fulfilled at the right and appropriate moment.
So that's why the controlling is very hard.
Yes, it is hard, but it is not impossible. It's not impossible. So
that elevated person, that Muni, he learned everything, and then still,
yes,
he came. So that is something.
Yes, but remember, this story is happening in the Satyuga. The world is still being formed, right? How many have been born? There is Brahma, and then Brahma's son is Manu. So it's way early in the civilization, in the creation process, right? It's Satyuga for sure. Now here we are in Kali Yuga. We are not supposed to go to Bindu Sarovar, right? We are not supposed to become munis and sannyasis, and sannyasis is prohibited in Kali Yuga, right? Even Vanprastha is prohibited. Where are the forests, right? Where will you live? So for us, what is the recommendation for this age? Varshana Mataji, what is the recommendation for this age? Unmute yourself and tell us. Recommendation for Kali Yuga is
chanting
the holy name of the Lord.
And what about the yoga to support that?
Hare Krishna, Hare Nama, Hare Nama, Hare Nama Kevalam, Kalu Nasi Eva Nasi
Eva Nasi Eva Nasi Eva Nasi. Association with the devotees.
Yes. So association is so very important. Time and again, you will see people who are standing there alone, even if they are in Satyuga, their mind can overtake them.
Mataji, one question can I ask?
Mm-hmm. It's so scary.
Mataji, sometimes what happens is in your, when you're chanting or you're doing anything, some stupid thought comes to your mind. And you keep praying to the Lord, please Lord, help me that these kind of thoughts should not come to my mind. So this is also sanskara?
Yes. Sanskara is what exactly is sanskara? Sanskara is the sum total of the thoughts that are stored in your mind. That is sanskara.
So, Mataji, even after praying also, they keep coming. So what should be done about it?
Nothing. Nothing different than what you're doing right now. As Prabhupada says, and Rupa Goswami explains in the Nectar of Instruction, where he says that a person who has got jaundice, right, does not like the taste of sugar cane, right? So in the beginning, we don't like to sit and chant. My mind will go here and there. But he says, just as sugar cane is the cure for jaundice, and the more sugar cane that you drink, even though you don't like it, ultimately it will cure you of jaundice, and then you'll start to relish the same sugar cane, which you didn't like in the first place because of too much of bile on the tongue. Right? So similarly, in the beginning, we don't like to do chanting. The mind goes here and there, but continue chanting. So that's why I was saying don't do nothing means don't do anything different. The solution to bad chanting is more chanting. Okay? Now, one of the things that you can do is that when there are thoughts, right? Thoughts like to manifest themselves. Keep this thing in mind. Thoughts will like to manifest themselves. So if there is a thought which is not so bad, Now different kinds of thoughts can come. But if it a thought is nagging you, like, you know, oh, what do I have to do? Oh, I have to soak the dal. And so compared to devotional service, this kind of a thought is such a mundane task, right? I have to do this, or I have to switch on the dishwasher, I have to switch on the washing machine. So these are all mundane thoughts. So doodh walna hai, right? Because these kind of thoughts will come early in the morning when you're sitting and chanting, because early in the morning you have to do so many things to run the whole day, right? So what you can do when these kind of thoughts are coming, have a pad and pencil next to you. Write it down. Write it down. Okay, I have to do this. Write it down. That's it. Then the mind gets subdued a little bit. The frequency of it reminding you that the same thing has to be done at every bead of the mala, that frequency will get reduced.
I usually divert my mind to lotus feet of Krishna.
There you go.
Flute or flower, something
yes.
like that.
Yes.
The
yes.
deity form, and I bring in front of my eyes there and I try to.
Right. Some people
myself.
Like, yes, very good. Some people like to have the deities there. So ideally, it is good to be doing this kind of practice. Your devotional service practice should be done in a place which you consider and designate as a sanctified place. So what I mean by that is that if I'm chanting on this sofa, then I should not eat also on this sofa. You see?
Oh. Then you're bedding.
Yeah. And then you're adding a little. So it's all about the ambience. You know, what's the ambience that you create around yourself? And you're saying, okay, I'm sitting down to chant. It's a serious thing. You know, I won't lie down on this sofa. Even how much more tired I am, I might want to go to another chair and lie down, or go to the bedroom and lie down. I will not lie down here. I will not take off my clothes and dump them here. Don't take off your clothes from the dryer and dump them on this sofa. Why? Because I have designated that this is the sofa where I do transcendental activities. Like that, you should designate your areas. All the ambience actually helps your mind also to get tuned to the ambience, which is para, right? Transcendental. So if the more you think, I'm going to chant in the kitchen, and right in front of the kitchen somewhere you see your dishwasher or you see your washing machine, the mind will think of washing machine, right? That's why I sit in front of the deity, as Vijayalakshmi Mataji was saying. She looked at the deity.
Not sitting in front of the deity, Mataji. I get pictures from
deity.
I get from Philadelphia. I get all the deity pictures every day.
That's deity. Is also deity. Yeah.
So with that, you know, I see that black Krishna in ISV and white Krishna in Philadelphia.
There you go.
So all the lotus feet, especially when I ask them, that's why they send the lotus feet with tulsi. So I just try to put my mind on that, not in front of me picture, but I get in my mind.
Very good. Yes, very good. Now, if the mind is misbehaving, yeah, yes, very good. So if you have reached that stage where you can just close your mind and think of Krishna, that's fantastic, right? But everybody might not be at that level. So we have to gain things from the environment. Somehow or the other, this mind has to be tamed, right? Mind has to be controlled.
Mind is monkey.
It's a monkey, yeah. Someday this will be a big monkey. Like that. So,
Mataji, mostly I hate myself. Where are you? I hate my head and where are you?
I have to do that sometimes.
Well, it was Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur who said that, you know, you should beat your mind with shoes for 500 times in the morning and then 500 times with a broom in the evening. So that it's tame. Well, he didn't mean that you literally have to beat it, because all that you're beating is your brain.
Like Mataji said, I also do like this.
Yeah, but it's not, yeah. Sometimes it can be dangerous, you know, to beat the head like that. So idea is to do it, because it's subtle, right? How much can we control? It's a subtle thing. Mind is subtle. So how can the mind be controlled? By putting it in the service of the Lord, and then by hearing, here's the important thing, that your mind will get clear. Cheto darpana marjanam bhavadhavagni nirvapanam, right? So you have to take the holy names of the Lord, and which is from Shikshastakam verse number 1, right? It's glorifying the holy names of the Lord. And so you do that. Or Shrinvatam Swakatha Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana. That's why we keep on saying read and listen to Krishna Katha, listen to Krishna Katha, because then it enters from your ear, and there's an invisible channel that we can see from the ear that connects to the heart, and the mind actually is in here, in the heart area, and the mind is not here, as you might think. This is the place for the brain, the difference between brain and the mind. The mind control happens from Krishna Katha, doing devotional service, doing service to the Lord, praising Him in the association of devotees, like that. That's how it gets cleared. So, yes, the task might seem overwhelming in the beginning. Why we might think, and why do you think the story of Karna Muni is there in Srimad Bhagavatam? It is for us to know. It is for us to realize that, you know, things like that can happen. Also to know that how deep-rooted our desires are. How deep-rooted our desires can get. That even when you are at that level of doing your austerity, still you want to get into a grihastha life. But, you know, in situations like that, we also have to remember that it's not, you cannot take, and we don't know. With scripture, there will be so many, like I was telling the other day, when you're reading the scripture, there will be so many times that you won't get the meaning and understand the scriptures, particularly with respect to Brahma Samhita, I was telling you that. And it's okay. It's okay for us not to be in a situation where I can't understand that, because I have not yet developed the entitlement to understand that. And it's only by, you know, serving your spiritual master and having faith in both spiritual master and the Lord will the imports of the Vedas reveal to you. Yasya deve parabhakti, yasya deve tathagaro, tasya te kathita hi artha prakashante mahatmana. So prakashante means will be revealed to you, the essence of the Shastra. So it's okay. Sometimes we don't understand, because we might just look at it. For example, the story of Ajamila. If a person is not a devotee of the Lord and listen to the story of Ajamila, he'll just shout and say, this is injustice, this is injustice, this is stupidity, some will also say. How come a person was so bad his whole life and they just chant the name of Narayan and then Yamdutas don't touch him like that, right? But then the same Bhagavatam, you go back again and read it with the eyes of a devotee, you'll just start glorifying the names of the Lord. You'll just say that, oh wow, the name of the Lord is so powerful. He just said Narayan. He was not even calling out to Narayan. He was just calling out to his son. It was very much, the name is so very powerful. The devotee looks at the same, reads the same story in a very different manner, like that. So you go back again and start reading the story of Karna Muni, and you'll say, no, Karna Muni, yes. After all, when God is going to come here in this material world, He needs a suitable family in which He's going to take birth, right? He's not going to be born in Jagai and Madai family, right? So He needs a good family. So who is much better than Karna Muni? And who is better than Devahuti, who is the daughter of Manu? Like that. And so Lord will set up all these things. Lord will create a desire in his heart, you know, and then be born in his family. So there are so many other ways, different ways of looking at the same thing like that. And so it's like Bhagavatam is like a cabbage. You keep on peeling and peeling and peeling. Layers upon layers and layers are like a lotus like that, you know, of infinite flowers. So here we are, and let us count the participant size for us, how much it is. Okay, it's 13.
That means the others have joined the meeting.
Anybody wants to take corporate book distribution goals? Is welcome to join our group. All right, thank you so much. And Sutapa, thank you so much. Sutapa, you might not like it, but we'll have to continue with this verse. There's a lot more. Yes. It's a very important verse, yeah, because God is talking more about it.
Yes, Mataji, I was about to say the same thing to you.
There you go. Okay, so then Sunday.
Sutapa, she just called me and reminded me today. And then I was too fast, and I started my class at 9 o'clock, your 9 o'clock. Then Mataji said, I am in the other meeting. Then I realized that I am too early for that.
And I was having a meeting, and suddenly Vijay Mataji pops up in the meeting, and she's saying, which class is this one? Like, this is not a class,
this is a meeting. That was the fun part today. I felt so embarrassed that Prabhu was saying, Vijayalakshmi Mataji is there.
He's from the same area, by the way. Yeah, he's from there. Yeah. Okay. All right.
Okay, thank you so much, Mataji.
Hare Krishna,
Hare Bol.